Grace, mercy, and peace are yours. From God, our Father, and from Jesus Christ, that faithful and great high priest. Dear friends, who walk with our Savior during this Lenten season. Is it possible to be too good? Can somebody be too perfect? Now, I'm no relationship expert, but I think I've read from time to time, or maybe seen somebody say something, that the person you're dating appears to be too perfect, too good. Might be that they're hiding something, and maybe there's something that they're not letting you know. I don't know if it's true or not. Maybe add to this thought. There was a girls' basketball team that beat their opponent 102-6. In the next game they played, they won 99-4. And then all the teams that were in their league refused to play them, dismissed them. Because their players were too talented. What about Jesus? Is he too perfect? Too great, too good to be the high priest? That's the word of God that I'm going to read here for a moment. Introduces him to be. These are the words of God from Hebrews chapter 5. The text is verse 7, 8, and 9, but I'm going to refer to earlier in that chapter as well. But these are the words of God. Hebrews 7, starting at verse 7. During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. You heard last week, when Pastor Krieger was with you, about the greatness of Jesus. From the very first chapter, the very first letter from the book, the letter to the Hebrews, we're introduced by the author to Jesus Christ, Son of God, creator of the universe, the divine essence of God himself. This grand announcement of who Jesus is. So that's why the question it was, is Jesus too perfect? Is Jesus too good to be our high priest? Because you need to understand, the high priest that God had set for his people from Moses' time on, remember Moses' brother Aaron, he was the first high priest. And these were the qualifications for someone who was going to be the high priest. This is the beginning of that chapter 7, the text in that verse 7. We're going to read verses 1 and 5, 1 and 2. Every high priest is selected from among the people and is appointed to represent the people in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He's able to deal gently with those who are ignorant and are going astray, since he himself is subject to weakness. So that's the description of who the people had as their high priest. And last week, again, you were reminded of how great and grand and majestic Jesus is. And so is he too perfect, too great? I mean, there's no doubt about it that Jesus is great. But is he too great? Is he too great to be able to interact and understand us who are sinful? Us who have ruined our lives by making bad choices and taking wrong behavior? This individual who is so great and so far above us, who is God, is Is he able to understand us? Can he really sympathize with us? We're sinful. He's divine. He's majestic. He's overwhelming. I mean, how could someone as possibly as great as God relate to sinners? See, that was a question that the Hebrews were probably struggling with. But they knew how great this individual was. And so how was he going to be able to relate to them? And that's why the author of the letter wrote the text that's before us tonight. And how Jesus would be able to relate with them. Yeah, he assures them that Jesus is not only our great high priest, as you heard last week, but he is our perfect high priest. Listen to the words again of the text. During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. It's Jesus Christ, our perfect high priest. You know, it might sound strange to hear what I've read now two times, to hear them tell us that Jesus was made perfect. Because that phrase conjures up some idea of somebody who wasn't perfect, who was imperfect, and who would gradually increase to perfection. He worked through all the errors, through all the difficulties and mistakes, and finally, he arose to being acceptable with no faults at all. See, that might sound strange because that's not what we're used to hearing about Jesus at all. And let's be clear, that's not what the author of the letter to the Hebrews was trying to say as well. No, he is talking about Jesus, and he describes him during Jesus' life on earth. Maybe a better translation would be in his flesh. He's talking about the human Jesus, the human being, Jesus Christ. Which, again, is distinct from what we heard last week from Pastor Krieger. Pastor Krieger presented this majestic, this one who is the divine essence of God, who knows all things, who created all things, who fills all things. That one who you know as incredible, majestic God, he is the one who became flesh. He is one who took on flesh and blood and lived as a human being on this earth. And in our text, the author takes us back to where we went in our reading this evening. Takes us to Gethsemane. Takes us where Jesus does what human beings do. Remember him giving directions to his disciples, talking to them, telling them what's going to be happening. Then he offered up prayers. This one is truly human. He says, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. And so from this human being that we know as Jesus, on that evening at Gethsemane, come cries out vocally, come tears from his eyes. Come sweat from his body that is described like blood. See, this author of this letter hasn't lost sight of who he described to you last week. That divine, majestic, marvelous God is here in this garden, going through what humans go through. You heard these words last week. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. And then you heard that grandness of Jesus. See, the author still has that in mind, as he wants them to know that he's a human. That's why he used the phrase, son though he was. Not son of Mary, even though he was. Not denying that. But he'd already talked about Jesus being the Son of God, and so he brings it again here in the seventh chapter. Son though he was, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And then once made perfect, he became the source of salvation for everyone who obeys him. So here we're reminded, this one that we know as Jesus of Nazareth is that very God that we worship in faith and that we honor and walk with him during the season of Lent. He is the Son of God. Jesus of Nazareth, also the very Son of God. So imagine yourself there with those disciples in Gethsemane. Imagine yourself looking at Jesus, hearing what's coming from his mouth, looking at him after he's prayed and the tears flowing down his cheeks. Seeing those big drops of sweat. See, there in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus was coming face to face with why he'd come to this world. The Lamb of God had come to take away the sins of the world, to carry them away. And he was at that point now. That time had come upon him. He was facing the guilt that all this world had accumulated. And it was being placed on him. On that human being. On that one born of Mary. All that pressure. All that penalty. All that judgment Jesus knew was going to be placed on him the very next day. And so as a human being, he cried. He prayed. As Jesus Christ, our perfect high priest. Perfect already in the way that he prayed. You know, imagine the guilt that you might have over one sin. Or one thing that you did in your life that you're ashamed of. Imagine the weight, the burden that you know. You've experienced it. Now think about those pictures of those criminals when they get caught or when they're being led from the police car to the courtroom. And they're trying to shield themselves. They're trying to avoid the cameras because they're ashamed. Think about who knows how many people troubled by that burden of guilt. No way to get any relief. Don't know how they're ever going to avoid it. Because they're pressed so hard. Decide to end it all. And here we have the Savior. Not carrying one sin. Being burdened, facing the penalty for all the world's sin as he's there in prayer and crying out to the Lord. And picture him lifting his knees out of that dirt, knowing that this traitor disciple was coming with those who were going to arrest him, and he goes right out toward them to meet them, to challenge them in some way. Because he is that perfect high priest. The very perfect one that we certainly need, friends. See, he is that God-man who is perfectly ready to be able to represent all of mankind before God. But see, you've already known that. You know him as the one that Mary learned about from an angel. An angel came to Mary and said she was going to have a child. And Mary said, well, how can that happen? I'm a virgin. It's impossible for me to have a child. And you know what the angel said? The Holy Spirit will come upon you. And the one that will be born of you is the Holy One of God. Key phrase, isn't that? The Holy One? Not somebody who gradually improve toward perfection. They're always perfect. The holy, amazing God, who through a miracle of the Holy Spirit was man, was born for you and for me. Remember what was said about him at his baptism, and then as you heard a few weeks ago at his transfiguration? This is my Son whom I love. And on one occasion the Father said, with him I am well pleased. What his disciple John wrote in his letter, 1 John, you know he appeared so that he might take away our sins, and in him is no sin. As he is our perfect high priest, perfect already in the way he prayed. But if that's true, if he is the perfect high priest, then how could he possibly pray what he did? If he's the perfect high priest, how could he, after looking at the dregs of woe that he was about to face, how could he then turn to his Father in prayer and plead, if it's your will, Lord, take this cup from me? How could he possibly pray that, knowing that there was no other way for salvation to have been won, to have been secured? How could he have learned anything? That's another thing that we hear in this text, that someone who learned obedience. How can the one who knows all things, the one who is God from eternity, how can he learn anything new? He already knows everything. And before you just give a simple answer, well, he's God, but he's also human. But let's stress, he's God. He's always God. This one who knows all things as God announced to his disciples the very things that were going to happen to him. He showed that he knew things. And so it wasn't just, well, he's a human being, so he didn't know. Well, the answer is, he humbly lived his life. There were times that he decided not to use what was divinely, what was eternally his, that he gave that up. He said, I'm not going to use that. I'm going to empty myself of those things. So he lived his life not parading around as God. It wouldn't have been a parade. He would have been God. But humbly learning things as a human being does. Humbly coming to experiences and appreciating things as a human being does. So the writer tells us that he learned obedience. And he did that in that humble way from the moment of his conception to the time that they took his body off that cross and laid it in a tomb. That he gave up the full and constant use of what was divinely his. So the author says, in the days of his flesh, yes, that one who you heard about last week, the one who created all things, even the angels, he allowed those angels to come and serve him, come and wait on him, come and help him as he was going to be the provider of salvation. He needed the aid of the angels, those very ones he created. He needed their aid and accepted their aid and truly appreciated their aid as they helped him. For he is our perfect high priest. Let's look at this one, offering up prayers and petitions with loud cries to the one who could save him from death. He never rebelled. He's not like a child that when the parents know they're sick, and the parents know a medicine's going to help them maybe get rid of a fever, get rid of an ailment. That child's had that medicine before and didn't like it, and so this time they slap the spoon and it spills all over because they don't want it. Jesus didn't do that at all. He willingly went where the Father commanded him to go. He willingly went and accepted what he had to take upon himself so that you and I could be freed from our sins. He used those words, "Not my will, but yours be done." And in his prayer, that perfect prayer, our perfect high priest, already perfect in prayer. Some people might say, well, I guess the Father didn't hear him. Things didn't go very well for him at all. He endured such a disgrace, such shame was brought on him, such a penalty was announced on him, condemned to death at the hands of the immoral and godless, or some false god, Romans, that they were. No. The Father heard him. The Father heard his son. And the Father rejoiced in what his son did. Because 3 days after his death, the Father brought him back to life. To give us joy. To let the Son rejoice in what he had accomplished, providing salvation, being victorious over the grave. Yes, glory be to that Savior who prayed the way that he prayed. Glory be to him. Why? For all the times when we prayed things and didn't trust the Father. For all those times when we said, "Hey, Lord, your will be done," but as quickly as things turned out in our life, when things didn't go our way, we quickly grumbled, we quickly complained, we kept quickly starting to wonder where God is. Because that's it. It's maybe easy to say your will be done, but it's a lot more difficult to actually pray it. Actually leave it in God's hand and say, "Lord, your will be done." That's hard to pray. You know, we look at our world all around in this world, God's views of sex and marriage, they're ignored because of what people want for themselves. God's claim that it's his time, it's his abilities, it's his gifts. No, those things are rejected by people saying, "No, it's my will, it's my money, it's my decision." And let's be honest, we're guilty of it as well. We might say it, and yet so often when we're really facing reality, we're hoping the Lord's going to do something else than let us go through such a situation. How thankful we are that Jesus prayed, "Thy will be done." He was focused on what his Father wanted. But not only was he perfect in prayer, friends, he was made perfect by the way that he obeyed. See, because, as I've already mentioned, it's hard to say it and pray it sometimes. Your will be done. Let's be honest, how much more difficult it is actually to do it, actually to obey and be faithful in what we say we're going to do and what we promise God. That's how much more difficult is it that to be faithful to God in every situation? And so here in our text, the author wrote those words. He learned obedience from what he suffered. See, here the author is leaving behind Gethsemane, leaving behind all that woe that Jesus was facing, all that anguish. He's leaving that behind and he's taking us to Golgotha. He's taking us to the place that it actually happened. Jesus went from thinking about it, contemplating in his mind, to actually having to do it, to actually having to live it out and face it and accept it and be obedient through it. That's what the author is taking us through. What Jesus theoretically was thinking it could be like to what he actually endured. This is a bad example. A short, doesn't really compare, but I'll use it anyway. Maybe like that young couple as they're getting married. And I guess it doesn't have to be a young couple. And how excited they are. They hear the words, "Will you love and cherish and honor?" And each one of them in excitement says, "Yes, I will. I do." And they're so into it. And it's great to see that. Until they learn what that actually means. When the husband has to say to his buddies, when it's time for the annual trip that they all like to go on, "I can't go. We need the money to cover some bills that have come up in our family." Or the young lady has to tell the girl she gets together for the weekly luncheon, "I'm not going to be able to attend. I'm not going to be able to join you this time because my husband needs me around to take care of some situations." See, there we learn obedience. We learn self-denial. We learn what it really means to not only say something, but actually follow through on it and carry it out. And yet we have to recognize how often we don't carry out what we say. How often we make promises, and yet those promises, though they were heard by some, maybe some many at times, we haven't been faithful to those promises. Whether it's promises parents make to children, whether it's promises members make in a confirmation vow, whether it's promises that husband and wife make to one another, we have to admit that we don't always do what we say we're going to do. We don't always let those words flow out in the actions that were intended to be made. So friends, we can rejoice. We can rejoice that not only did Jesus say he was going to do the Father's will, but that he actually did it. He actually did everything that was required by his Father to provide salvation. He took all of those times that we hurt God, that we ignored God, and at times brought hurt to the people that we love in our life, and we disgraced in our life, and we shamed. Jesus took all of that on himself because that was the Father's will, that he be the one that carried the penalty in order to provide salvation for people who didn't obey. And Jesus not only said he would do it, how thankful we are that he did it. See, that is what makes him that perfect high priest for us. See, he would not be the perfect high priest if all he did was live perfectly, follow every guideline that a human being is supposed to do, and follow it straight down the line his entire life. He would not be a perfect high priest if he would have said, "But I'm not going to die for him. I did what I was expected to do." Because if he wouldn't have done the bearing of the penalty, then the just God of heaven would still have a penalty to hand out, a penalty that hadn't been met, a penalty that he wasn't going to ignore. So Jesus is the perfect high priest, not only living his life perfectly, but also then, through that perfection, giving you the righteousness that you lack. And then in his death and suffering the penalty, taking your sins upon himself so that you don't have to face the wrath of God. You don't have to worry about anything coming your way because Jesus has covered it completely. Yes, he has perfectly provided all that we need, friends. And so it is what this text says. The words are somewhat, maybe get your ears to ring a little bit, that he become the source of salvation for everyone who obeys him. salvation by grace. What happened? To Jesus doing it. Jesus providing redemption. Jesus carrying the penalty away. We are free from the ruin that we had coming. The words to the Hebrews, once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. Again here, friends, the author to the Hebrews isn't introducing a new idea. What he states here is perfectly in line with salvation by grace. Because Scripture teaches faith as something that is obedient to God. That's obedience. See, God not only says you're saved by faith, he commands that you are going to be saved by faith. And so he uses the word of God, and the Holy Spirit uses that word to bring us that faith that we need. And when he gives us that faith, we throw away all that desire that I'm going to do it myself. We throw away all that thought, well, I'm acceptable to God. He's going to be pleased with me. We throw that all away and we rest entirely on Jesus and on Jesus alone, knowing that he has satisfied God. He has brought righteousness. And then he says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. And his words, the Holy Spirit uses to give us that rest, to unite us to Jesus, so we are obediently walking with him and have the salvation that's ours. And now having that salvation, yes, we obediently look for ways that we're going to honor him. We're going to live for him. We're going to serve him. We're going to rejoice over what he's done. See, what the author to the Hebrews says is exactly what God says. He commands our faith, and he accomplishes it. And we walk with him through that gift of faith that he's given us. Yes, we have a perfect high priest, a one in his prayer life who demonstrated perfection, and one through what he suffered, what he experienced, accomplished, finished the salvation. You know, the words may have troubled us, and we're not going to go back over it, but once made perfect, I've already commented on it enough. Once made perfect, maybe a better translation would be, what's the new version that many Lutheran pastors were working on. This is how that phrase is translated now. Brought to his goal. The phrase, once made perfect, might be better translated, brought to his goal, or finished his goal. Because what Jesus said on the cross, remember those words that he said on the cross about his work being done? It is finished. That's the same root word that phrase that you've heard now translated made perfect, or also translated finished his goal. It's the same root word. It has the same meaning. When Jesus said it is finished, he was talking about the work of salvation being finished. And so what the author to the Hebrews is saying that he finished his goal. He reached his goal. He was perfect, made perfect, and all that was required of him, he did it completely. Let's rejoice in that, because he is that perfect high priest that he and he alone can be. And how wonderful it is, friends, to know him and to honor him. We continue to do that as we walk with him in Lent. Amen.